Hello class, in the last lecture we discussed about the topic radioactive series such as uranium series, actinium series, thorium series, and also we solved the problems based on off-life, main life. Okay, in the present lecture I am going to discuss about the contents. What are the conditions required for alpha decay, range of alpha particles, the third one, Geiger's law for range of alpha particle. Then we will discuss Geiger-Newton's law. Then after alpha gamma theory for the explanation of alpha particle decay. Okay.
Yes. What is alpha decay? Alpha decay is nothing but the emission of alpha particles by the radioactive substances. We know that its general representation ZXA gives rise to alpha particle, we denote it as 2He4 plus the daughter nucleus Z minus 2Y A minus 4. Yes, we know here atomic number decreased 2 units, mass number decreased 4 units, right? Now, the present discussion is, what are the conditions required for the alpha decay? The first condition is, charge should be conserved. That is, conservation of charge must be required. The second condition is, conservation of nucleon number. Conservation of nucleon number, right? The third condition required is conservation of linear momentum. Conservation of linear momentum. And one more condition should obey in this alpha decay process is conservation of mass energy. Conservation of mass energy. Okay, so let us see one by one conservation of charge. So for this, let us take one example. Simply, 92 uranium-238 that gives rise to, by emitting the alpha particle 2He4, we got 90 thorium-234, right? So here atomic number 92 left side, right side we have for alpha particle 2, for thorium 90. So, since it represents the proton number, here the charge plus 92, here the charge plus 2, here the charge plus 90. 90 plus 2 on right hand side, on left hand side 92 units of positive charge. Therefore, the charge is conserved. Okay. The second condition, nucleon number. So, left side we have the mass number 238. Means what? The total number of nucleons is nothing but mass number, that is both protons and neutrons. On right hand side of the equation, here we have the 4, here 234. 234 plus 4 equal to 238. Therefore, nuclear number is also conserved. The third condition is the conservation of linear momentum. So for that, simply, same I am writing the equation ZXA gives rise to alpha particle 2He4 plus Z minus 2Y A minus 4. So this is what? This is parent nucleus. Parent nucleus. It is alpha particle, right? This is daughter nucleus. Daughter nucleus. Let us consider the parent nucleus as MP, alpha particle mass M alpha, daughter nucleus or daughter nucleide mass say MD. In the alpha decay process, the energy must be released. So that is I am writing ED plus E alpha, where ED represents the kinetic energy of the daughter nucleide or daughter nucleus. E alpha stands for kinetic energy of the alpha particle. So that means what? So here the sum of the parent nucleus, the mass of the parent nucleus on left hand side we have On right hand side we have the alpha particle and daughter nucleus. So the total sum of the masses of alpha particle and daughter nucleus will be less than that of the parent nucleus. So then there will be some mass defect delta m. According to Einstein mass energy relation, that is E is equal mc square. So then for mass defect delta m, the energy delta E equal delta m into c square energy can be released. This energy we represent as Q. That energy is called disintegration energy. Disintegration energy. So in alpha decay, the energy released or the energy emitted in that process is called disintegration energy. We denote it as Q. So where Q is equal the daughter nucleus kinetic energy plus alpha particle kinetic energy. Nothing but this disintegration energy will be shared to the daughter nucleus and the alpha particle. So that is we have shown here ED and E alpha. So why the disintegration energy released? Because of the mass defect. What is the mass defect? Here the mass difference between the total sum of the products to the parent nucleus. According to that mass defect, equivalent energy should be delta m into c square. According to what? Einstein mass energy relation. Right. Q equal ED plus E alpha. Okay. So now let m be parent nucleus, alpha particle mass m alpha, daughter nucleus mass m d. Right. Now suppose that if the parent nucleus is at rest and it is emitting the alpha particle, then the initial speed of parent nucleus is zero, alpha particle speed say v alpha, and the daughter nucleus speed say vd, right? And momentum, linear momentum of parent nucleus equal to zero because it is at rest. Alpha particle momentum would be mass into its speed, m alpha v alpha, right? Then the parent nucleoid momentum equal to its mass, product of mass and its speed md into vd, right? According to the conservation of linear momentum, so what is that? Before the decay, the total momentum, initial momentum should be equal to final momentum of the products. Initial momentum is zero because the parent nucleus is at rest. The total final momentum, that equal to momentum of alpha particle plus the linear momentum of daughter nucleus MdVd. From this we can write m alpha v alpha is equal minus MdVd, right? From this, what can we observe from this? Yes, here both alpha particle and the daughter nucleus have the same linear momentum in magnitude and they are in opposite direction. So therefore, they will move with the same momentum in opposite direction. That is, the magnitude of alpha particle linear momentum equal to the magnitude of the momentum of the daughter nucleus. Right. So therefore, the ratio of momentums of alpha particle and daughter nucleus, that is P alpha by PD, equal to 1:1. So this kind of question will be asked in entrance examinations. What is the ratio of linear momentum of alpha particle and daughter nucleus? 1:1. Right. We know that kinetic energy is equal to half mv square, right? If a particle of mass m is moving with the speed v, then its kinetic energy expression we write half mv square. That equal to what? P square by 2m. Okay. When p is constant, then kinetic energy inversely proportional to m. Okay. So in this process, in the alpha decay process, kinetic energy of alpha particle and the daughter nucleus is the same. So here P constant. Therefore, the ratio of kinetic energies of alpha particle and daughter nucleus we can write E alpha by ED equal to MD, mass of the daughter nucleus by alpha particle mass M alpha, the inverse ratio of their masses. Okay, and also one more point we will discuss here. We have the expression for disintegration energy, that is the energy released in the alpha decay process, that is shared to both alpha particle and the parent nucleus. Hence we write ED, that is kinetic energy of daughter nucleus, E alpha, kinetic energy of alpha particle. So that equals to Q equal to ED plus E alpha, say equation 1. But E, Q is equal to, here what we have, Q is equal to, according to this equation, the rest mass energy of parent nucleus MPC square, rest mass energy of alpha particle M alpha C square, for daughter nucleus its rest mass energy MD into C square, right? Therefore we can write Q is equal to MP C square minus M alpha C square minus MD C square, that equal to MP minus M alpha minus MD into C square, say equation 2. So therefore the disintegration energy or energy released in the alpha decay process of any radioactive element is given by MP minus M alpha minus MD into C square, where it is mass of the parent nucleus, alpha particle mass, it is the daughter nucleus mass, C speed of light, that is 3 into 10 power 8 meter per second. If MP, M alpha, MD substituted in AMU, because one atomic mass unit equals to 931.5 MeV, then simply you can calculate Q is equal to, so this total, say mass defect delta M into 931.5 MeV. So using this expression you can calculate in million electron volts. If you want to express in electron volts, you multiply with 10 power 6. If you want to express that in joules, how we write, delta M into 931.5 into 10 power 6 electron volts, that equal to, where delta M is in AMU, you substitute directly 931.5 into 10 power 6, but 1 electron volt equal 1.6 into 10 power minus 19 joules, right? So in this way, you can calculate the disintegration energy in terms of MeV, in terms of electron volts and joules. Okay, now let us take the equation 1. So what is that? Q is equals to the kinetic energy of daughter nucleus and alpha particle. So that equal to, this is kinetic energy of MD VD square plus it is of M alpha V alpha square, right? But we have M alpha V alpha is equal minus MD VD. MD VD. Momentums are equal in magnitude, but directions are opposite. From this, you write VD. What we write? Minus M alpha V alpha by MD. Substituting that in the above equation, Q is equal to 1 by 2 MD. VD is M alpha V alpha whole square by MD square plus of M alpha V alpha square. So here one MD cancel out. So then what we have, 1 by 2 M alpha square V alpha square by MD plus of M alpha V alpha square. By taking common of M alpha V alpha square, right, then 1 plus M alpha by MD, 1 plus M alpha by MD, that equals to half M alpha V alpha square is what, this is the kinetic energy of alpha particle E alpha into 1 plus m alpha by m d. So what we get, Q is equals to E alpha into 1 plus m alpha by m d, right? From this it is very clear, Q equal E alpha plus something, or E alpha equal to Q by 1 plus m alpha by m d. So here it is very clear, E alpha less than Q. Kinetic energy of alpha particle less than the total energy emitted in that process. That means something, some part of energy is shared to the parent nucleus. So thus that thing we will observe from this. Okay, Q equal to E alpha into this one. Then E alpha is equal to Q by 1 plus M alpha by MD. Okay. So this is equal to Q into MD by M alpha plus MD. Then you can write what is the ratio of kinetic energy of alpha particle to total disintegration energy. This is nothing but the fraction of kinetic energy of alpha particle, or the part of kinetic energy of the alpha particle, equal to simply formula MD by M alpha plus MD. Suppose if you want to calculate kinetic energy of daughter nucleus, that is ED by EQ is equal 1 minus of this, 1 minus of E alpha by Q, you will get M alpha by M alpha plus MD. Okay. From these two expressions, then E alpha, by dividing these two, E alpha by ED equal to, you will get MD by M alpha. So these three relations are useful in entrance point of examinations. What is the fraction of kinetic energy of alpha particle? MD by M alpha plus MD. What is the fraction of kinetic energy of daughter nucleus? ED by Q equal M alpha by M alpha plus MD. What is the ratio of kinetic energy of alpha and daughter nucleus? Inverse ratio of their masses. What is the ratio of their momentums? 1:1. Okay. These are the important relations, so you should remember. So what I am saying is, here in alpha decay process, four conservations must be obeyed. One is charge conservation. The second one, nuclear number conservation should be obeyed. The third, linear momentum should be conserved, and mass energy should be conserved. These four conservations must be obeyed in the alpha decay process. The next concept we are going to discuss is, what is the range of alpha particle? Alpha range. Yes. Alpha particle is nothing but what we have, 2He+2. That is nothing but, it is a helium nucleus. So it has 2 units positive charge, right? And mass m is equal to 4 units, 4 amu, or 4 times to the proton mass, because proton mass is equal to we have 1 amu, right? When the alpha particle is passing through some gas, right, that can ionize the gas. So due to decreasing of its alpha particle kinetic energy, and it goes slow down, right? So then up to, it can travel through the gas up to its energy falls to the ionization potential of that gas. So therefore, the range is defined as, it is the distance traveled by the alpha particle in the gas until its kinetic energy falls to below the ionization potential of that gas. Because whenever its kinetic energy, ionization potential is nothing but how to understand, the energy required to remove the electron from the neutral atom, right? When the alpha particle is traveling through the gas, so then that can remove the electron from the neutral atoms, and the ions are forming, positive ions are producing. In such a way, the kinetic energy of alpha particle gradually decreases at some time its energy reduces to below the ionization potential energy of that gas. Therefore, so during that period, how much distance it covered, that is called as the range of alpha particle. So alpha particle range, it depends on three factors. One is initial kinetic energy of the particle. The second one, nature of the gas. The third point is pressure of the gas, right? The range of alpha particle emitting from any radioactive substance depends on three factors: its initial kinetic energy and the nature of the gas, pressure of the gas. The range of alpha particle in air generally expressed in centimeter, because in the order of centimeter, 3 centimeter, 6 centimeter maximum, it is expressed at STP and temperature. It is expressed at NTP, and that is pressure is 76 centimeter of Hg pressure and temperature at 15 degree centigrade. Okay, so regarding the range of alpha particle, Geiger proposed a formula, that is Geiger formula, we call it as the range of alpha particle. It is directly proportional to cube of the speed. R is equal to constant A into V cube, where A is the proportionality constant. Okay. But the kinetic energy E is equal to, in terms of speed, of m V square, right? So from this it is very clear E proportional to V square, or V proportional to E power of. So this is say equation 1, right? It is the equation 2. Okay, from these two equations we can relate R proportional to V cube in terms of kinetic energy E power 3 by 2. R is equal proportionality constant B into E power 3 by 2. This is the range of alpha particle in terms of kinetic energy. It is the range of alpha particle in terms of speed. Question in entrance, question may be asked like this: the range of alpha particle is proportional to A, V square, some V cube, V root V, something V power 3 by 4 and so on. Answer is V cube. The range of alpha particle is proportional to, options will be E power of, E square, and E power 2, E power 3 by 2. So option is E power 3 by 2. So this is the Geiger's law. So after that, based on experimental results, Geiger and Noetel formulated an empirical relation for the range of alpha particle, that is called Geiger-Noetel's law. So what is that? It's very important. Geiger-Noetel's law of alpha decay, range of alpha particle, that is log lambda is equal A plus B log R. Okay, where lambda is decay constant or disintegration constant of radioactive element. R is nothing but a range of alpha particle, where A, B are constants. So here let us recap some points. We have the half life T off is equal 0.693 by lambda. Okay, here how T off related with lambda, it is inversely proportional to lambda. So from this expression, as lambda value increases, R value increases. As lambda value increases, T off value decreases. So the radioactive elements having the short half life or the large disintegration constant will have the more range of alpha particle. Let me repeat. If lambda is more, R is more. Right, lambda more is nothing but half life is less. So radioactive elements having the short half life or high disintegration constant will emit the alpha particles of high range alpha particles. Okay, so that will be, you can understand from this Geiger-Newton's law. To explain this Geiger-Newton's law, Gamow treated the quantum concept. By using the wave mechanics and Schrodinger equation, he explained the Geiger-Newton's law experiment. So that is exactly agreement with the experimental results. According to classical theory, when the alpha particle, generally any radioactive substance emitting the alpha particle kinetic energy is in the order of 5 MeV to 9 MeV maximum, right? But the nucleus, inside the nucleus, nucleus potential barrier, it is in the order of 26 MeV. For example, if you take the radioactive substance 92 uranium 238, right? So its potential energy, that is the height of the potential barrier, is equal to almost 26 MeV. But alpha particle kinetic energy is in between 5 MeV to 9 MeV. According to classical physics, the alpha particle having the lesser kinetic energy than that of the potential barrier, potential energy of the potential barrier, there is no possibility to penetrate through this potential barrier. So probability of leakage of the alpha particle coming out from the nucleus through the potential barrier, P equals to zero as per the classical mechanics. So therefore alpha decay was explained by the Gamow by using the quantum mechanical concepts. Because since the alpha particle speed is in the order of 1.4 into 10 power 7 meter per second to 2.05 into 10 power 7 meter per second, right? So for moving particle, the wave is existing. That wave is called de Broglie wave. By considering the de Broglie wave concept, if it is a wave, wave has the probability to leak through the potential barrier. So that effect is called tunneling effect. So when we consider the quantum mechanics, right, here alpha particle is associated with the de Broglie wave. So then that is considered as the wave. Though it has the less kinetic energy than the potential energy of that potential barrier, that can penetrate, that can leak through the potential barrier. That effect is called tunneling effect. So by using the concept of tunneling effect, Gamow successfully explained this Geiger-Newton's law. So this the formula derived by the Gamow, so that exactly good agreement with the experimental results given by the Geiger-Newton's law. So this is the Geiger-Newton's law. The next concept we will discuss is Gamow's theory. What is the Gamow's theory? Yes, the Gamow's theory, for that let me repeat the concepts. Quantum mechanics provides the successful explanation of alpha decay, but the classical mechanics was unable to explain the phenomenon. According to the quantum mechanics, it is possible for an alpha particle to leak through the potential barrier even though its kinetic energy is less than the potential energy of the height of the potential barrier. That effect we call it as tunneling effect. To explain that, some basic points we have to consider. There, one is alpha particle may exist as an entity within a heavy nucleus. Alpha particle may exist as an entity within a heavy nucleus. That is the first consideration. The second consideration is alpha particle is in constant motion inside the nucleus. So that can bounce with the walls of the nucleus or potential barrier. So in each bounce, there is a probability of leakage. This is the second consideration. The third consideration is in each bombardment with the wall, so there is a definite probability that the particle will leak through the potential barrier. To explain the alpha decay, the three considerations taken. One is alpha particle may exist as an entity within a heavy nucleus, first one. The second, that alpha particle will be in the constant motion and collides with the walls of the nucleus. The third, in each collision or bombardment with the walls of the nucleus, there is a probability to leak out through the potential barrier. So, suppose if nu is the frequency of alpha particle colliding with the walls and p is the probability of transmission in each collision, then the decay probability per unit time, the decay probability per unit time, we can write it as lambda equals to nu into p. This is equation 1. What I am saying, if nu is the frequency of colliding with the walls of the nucleus, p is the probability of transmission in each collision, then the decay probability per unit time, lambda equal to nu into p. This is equation 1. Now, regarding this, you have to understand this diagram. Here I am taking the graph between the distance from center of nucleus on x-axis, potential energy V of E taken on y-axis, right? So then that will be like this. Okay, so here this is the potential barrier, the wave penetrated through the potential barrier, so this represents the wave function psi, right? So this is the maximum potential energy V maximum equal to V naught, this is minus V naught. Okay, this is the center of the nucleus, capital R represents the radius of the nucleus, it is R1, that equal 2 ZE square by 4 pi epsilon naught T. Don't confuse, I will explain one by one. Here the graph is drawn between potential energy of the alpha particle versus potential energy versus the distance. Say consider this is a nucleus, right? Center of the nucleus O and radius is say capital R, right? Then this will be the thickness of the nucleus, that we call it as potential barrier. So if it is R, say this total R1. Therefore this will be the R1 minus R represents, this is the thickness of the potential barrier, right? So here the alpha particle is considered as some particle existing inside the nucleus. First thing, that alpha particle is in the motion, constant motion, and it is colliding with the walls. Second, in that collision that can penetrate through this potential barrier. These are the things we considered. Okay. So here actually in this alpha particle energy, kinetic energy is 5 MeV to 9 MeV cell. But the potential energy, what is the potential energy? The potential barrier is in the order of 26 MeV. What is the physical meaning of potential barrier? Physical meaning of potential barrier is what? Yes. So here inside the nucleus, there exists the potential energy of the alpha particle. We write V equal to 1 by 4 pi epsilon naught according to the formula Q1 Q2 by R, 1 by 4 pi epsilon naught. Q1 charge of alpha particle 2E, suppose if Q2 is the charge apparent this daughter nucleus charge plus ZE into ZE by R equal to 2 ZE square by 4 pi epsilon naught R. So due to this potential energy, the alpha particle is bounded inside the nucleus. Because of this potential energy, it is held inside the nucleus, right? So whenever we are giving some energy equivalent to this potential energy, that will come out easily from the nucleus. According to classical physics, we talk that one. So what we talk according to classical physics, when the particle has the potential energy this much, suppose if the kinetic energy given to equal to that amount, then that will come out from the nucleus. But here, alpha particle energy is very less compared to 26. It is 5 MeV to 9 MeV. So its kinetic energy is less than 26 MeV. So there is no possibility to cross this potential barrier. But wave mechanics explain this. Quantum mechanics explain this. According to the tunnel effect, though the alpha particle have the less kinetic energy, that can penetrate through this potential. Well, so in this figure, 0 is the center of the nucleus or radius of the nucleus, right? So this thickness of this nucleus, this potential barrier R2, R1, capital R2, R1 is the potential barrier, right? This represents the kinetic energy of the alpha particle. So this is the potential well. This total nucleus we treat it as the potential well. The maximum potential energies at this potential barrier V maximum, that equal 26 MeV, right? At R equal to R1, when alpha particle at this potential at the edges, at the boundary, then the attraction force is the, inside the nucleus we know that short range attractive forces exist. The short range because of the short range nuclear forces, that alpha particle is bounded in that nucleus, right? So at the boundary of this nucleus, then the because of the Coulomb repulsive forces, that can be balanced by this short range forces. Therefore, at that point at R equal to R1, so that here at this point, potential energy equal to kinetic energy. Potential energy how much? 2 ZE square by 4 pi epsilon naught R1 equal to kinetic energy. Then R1 equals to, we write 2 ZE square by 4 pi epsilon naught T. Don't confuse. This is the center of the nucleus. R is the nucleus radius. From R equal to R2, R1, this is the potential barrier, that is the thickness of the nucleus. So potential barrier height 26 MeV, physical meaning is the potential energy at the boundaries. When the alpha particle crossing this one, their kinetic energy must be equal to this potential energy. So therefore 2 ZE square by 4 pi epsilon naught. After crossing that, then repulsive potential exists. Inside the, whenever it is inside the nucleus, the potential energy is negative. Potential energy negative is physical meaning what? So it is bounded. So the alpha particle is existing inside the nucleus, right? Once it is crossed the potential barrier, then the repulsive potential exists because the nucleus has the positive charge, alpha particle has positive charge, then repulsion force exists. Once it is inside the nucleus, then it is bounded by this one. So it has the negative potential energy, that equal 26 MeV. So inside the well, this total potential energy equal to this one. When it is crossing or it is leaking through the potential barrier at the point R equal to R1, potential energy is equal to kinetic energy of the alpha particle. So based on these concepts, let us go for derivation, right? So the first equation, what we have written, the first equation, the decay probability lambda is equal frequency of the collision nu into probability p, equation 1, right? So here, suppose if r is the radius, then in one collision at two walls, right? We can write to frequency, time period t is equal, time taken between two collision, t equal to total distance covered 2r by the speed of the alpha particle v, then frequency equal reciprocal of time period v by 2r. So here nu equal to v by 2r. This is equation 2, sir. Right. So by using the WKB perturbation theory, or simply this is in higher classes you will study, simply by using the quantum mechanics concept, direct we are taking the expression log p base e is equal to minus 2 by h cut, that is h by 2 pi, into integral r to r1 square root of 2m into v of r minus t dr. This is equation 3. Okay. By using the quantum mechanics, right, we are writing the probability, we are writing the decay probability per unit time, decay probability per unit time p, then log p base e equal to this one, right? So where, what is the potential energy function v of r? That is 1 by 4 pi epsilon naught q1 q2 alpha particle charge 2e, daughter nucleus atomic number say z, then that will be plus ze by r equals to 2 ze square by 4 pi epsilon naught r. Okay. So this is electrostatic potential energy of alpha particle at the distance r from the center of the nucleus. Then, so potential energy, we know that one here. At r is equals to, at r equals to r1, what I am saying, the potential energy should be equal to kinetic energy of alpha particle, right? That is 2 ze square by 4 pi epsilon naught r1 equal to t, okay, equal to t. So taking this cross multiplication, t r1 equal to 2 ze square by 4 pi epsilon naught r, 4 pi epsilon naught. Instead of you substitute this value here, you substitute this value here, so then what we write, log p base e equals to minus 2 by, this is h by 2 pi, you write as it is, integral r to r1, right, 2m square root of that, 2m into v of r, 2 ze square by 4 pi epsilon naught r minus t into dr, t into dr. Okay, so 2 ze square by 4 pi epsilon naught, so you can write tr1, then what we get, log p base e is equal minus 2 by h by 2 pi integral capital R to R1 square root of 2m into T R1 by R minus T dr. Okay. So that equals to minus 2 by h by 2 pi integral capital R to R1, taking T common, square root of 2mt into R1 by R minus 1 dr. Okay. Say this is equation 5, sir. But the integral capital R to R1